You viewed a film you like. What stays with you when you leave the theater? The images, certainly, but underneath those images is the element that blends those pictures together, creating the mood that sticks with you long after the viewing. That element is music. Hello, my name is Elwy Jost, and this edition of The Movie Makers is an exploration of film music. Tonight we have a group of Hollywood's most distinguished composers to talk about their work. Our guests include Henry Mancini, who wrote the familiar Pink Panther scores, as well as the Oscar-winning song, Moon River. John Green, composer and adapter for the screen of the score from Oliver. David Raskin, who composed the classic Laura. Miklos Rozsa, whose credits include Hitchcock's Spellbound and William Wyler's Ben-Hur. Saul Chaplin, veteran of countless MGM musicals. And Lional Newman, head of the 20th Century Fox Music Department. Join me now for an intimate view of film music from the men who wrote it. Miklos Rozsa, you've adapted classical forms, haven't you, sir? And I'm thinking of ballet, I'm thinking of opera, I'm thinking of symphonic modes, all to screen music. Would you care to go into that in a little detail?
Well, you see, I came very late, actually. I was nearly 30 years old, 28, and I came to the cinema, and I was already a composer, if I may say so, well known for his symphonic and chamber music works. So my training is entirely classical. I am a product of the Leipzig Conservatory where I studied at the university. See, I studied musicology as well as composition. And so I think this shows in all my so-called cinematographic compositions as well, because I try to write symphonic music.
What about the film noir? Because it had many dark aspects. All of these have, even some mystery films that you've done, which have this element, is in Spellbound. There's an element there,
well,
of dark fantasy.
This is somewhat different. You see, in Hollywood, I always say Beethoven only had three periods, in great periods in his life. In Hollywood, I had four. So this is one-upmanship on Beethoven.
What were they?
Well, the first was The Oriental, started with The Thief of Baghdad, and went on for about 10 films, The Jungle Book, and so on.
That's right.
And the second one was my psychological. We started with Spellbound, then came The Lost Weekend, then came another 10 films with all psychological problems and Freudian problems.
Leaning over the sloping roof of a high building was the man with the beard. I yelled at him to watch out. Then he went over, slowly, with his feet in the air. And then I saw the proprietor again, the man in the mask. He was hiding behind a tall chimney, and he had a small wheel in his hand. I saw him drop the wheel on the roof. Suddenly, I was running. Then I heard something beating over my head. It was a great pair of wings. The wings chased me and almost caught up with me when I came to the bottom of the hill.
And then I did The Killers. Which had a theme which you probably remember, which was like this: dum da dum dum, dum da dum dum dum.
This is the picture with Burt Lancaster and
yes.
Albert Dekker.
That's
Ava,
right.
Gardner.
Oh, your memory is fantastic.
No. I just love it. To get that, let's talk about that theme, the creative process, sir, that led you to that final thing that we hear on the screen with the dum-da-dum-dums.
Well, it was a theme that had to be short. It's had to be a motive Because very often we see the killers, we know about the killers, that they're either coming, or they are there, or they are talked about, or the menace is there, but we don't see him. But the music can tell you. If it would be a long theme, you know, of 8 bars, no. But it is a bum 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 bum. That's enough, you know? So that's what happens. There was one scene I remember that they were in a bar, the bar pianist is playing a boogie-woogie. I played the boogie-woogie, you know, my boogie-woogie is rather questionable. But anyway, for that scene was all right, you know. Somebody played boom 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 boom, and I played all the variation about it. And suddenly the orchestra comes in. You know, so you don't see anything, but you know the menace is there.
Shivering. You know, I could stand here all day and listen to you play that, John Green. I think it's one of the finest things you've ever composed.
Well, thank you. It's an interesting thing about that, Elwy, that, body and soul is kind of, thank God for it, too, my trademark everywhere. And I don't badmouth body and soul at all. I am deeply grateful that I wrote it, and I love it.
It's a classic.
But when people say, as the composer, what's your favorite song of all the songs you've written? I have to say it's Rain Tree County.
They say in Rain Tree County there's a tree bright with blossoms of gold. But you will find the Rain Tree's estate of the mind are a dream to enfold. It was there one day with the buds of early May that you came like a flame from the south. And I looked into eyes of periwinkle blue, and I knew, then I knew, I'd love you in Rain Tree County.
John, in a few easy steps here for us. You'll love the word easy. How did you adapt the successful stage musical Oliver to the screen?
Well, that was a very big process, Elwy. It's the kind of thing, not meaning to sound pompous, on which I have given multi-hour seminars in cinema departments at universities. In the brief time that we have, I can't answer that efficiently. Let me say that it was a big, big process. The way the show was conceived by Lionel Bart in the theater, it was a chamber piece. It was highly stylized scenically, directorially. It had a tiny orchestra of 16 players. And it was, as I say, it was stylized, it was not realistic. We changed the whole concept of that in making the picture. And by we, I mean Sir Carol Reed, who directed mm-hmm. it, Anna White, who choreographed it, John Box, who designed it, and I. And we went right back to Dickens, and we recreated London of 1850, and did it realistically. My basic orchestra, not that all the players were playing all the time, don't get me wrong, but the basic orchestra in Oliver was a symphony orchestra. in the film was 74 players as against 16. Just as an example. And when you stop to think of the way we did consider yourself in the film, in the market section of 19th century, mid-19th century London, we had 300 people in that number.
Oh, vastly different.
You know, it was a whole different concept.
Were many of the songs different and the pieces different in the film? Would there be new things created, new pieces of music created?
Interesting that you asked that question, Elwy. In our contract with Lionel Bart, who wrote, by the way, book, lyrics, and music for the original stage play, which we were adapting, he had to write us four new songs for the film at our behest. And as a matter of fact, we did require him to write three new songs, no one of which ever got before the cameras.
David Raskin.
I had been studying in Philadelphia at two remarkable schools. One was called Central High School, which is just a great place. I went from there to the University of Pennsylvania, where I studied. All the time I was working as a professional. I had my own band when I was 14.
Really?
I started arranging when I was about 15 or 15 and a half, and started composing soon after that. And while I was at the University of Pennsylvania, I learned a considerable amount. When I finished there, I went off to New York, where I played in bands and arranged for bands and all that sort of thing. And eventually I wound up doing radio. And from there, well, George Gershwin heard an arrangement I made of one of his tunes and recommended me to a publishing house, Harms in Chapel. They hired me, and I went to work for them. And when I was in Boston, out of town with one of those shows, during out-of-town tryouts, I got a telegram from Hollywood asking me if I'd like to come out and work with Charlie Chaplin on Modern Times.
Well, this would be 36 period, would it?
35. And so I came out to Hollywood and worked with Charlie on Modern Times, and that was the beginning of my stay here.
Well, tell us about Charlie, and tell us what it was like to work with that man on Modern Times.
Well, he, of course, Charlie Chaplin was one of a kind. I don't think there's ever been anybody else quite like him, nor is there likely to be one like him. He was, nobody needs to have me say he was a brilliant, wonderful man. He was not used to being differed with or defied, and I was just young enough to express myself when I disagreed with him about things, and after a very brief time, about a week and a half, he fired me.
What a way to start.
Yes, wasn't it? And that really hurt.
I guess.
But he didn't know how to write music down. And he didn't know how to develop his ideas, how to extend them. He'd come up with little phrases or fragments. He needed somebody to help. So that's what I was doing. And I disagreed with him about some of the things he was doing. I now look upon that as arrogance. But I wanted the music to be as good as it could possibly be. Well, anyhow, Alfred Newman, who was going to conduct that picture, which was Modern Times, got a look at the sketches I'd been making of the music, and said to Charlie, "You'd be crazy to fire this guy. You have no idea what he's doing with his music." So Charlie sent out a feeler saying he'd like to rehire me, and I said, under no conditions, unless I can have a real understanding with him, because otherwise he'd just fire me again. So I had a session with him, which lasted several hours, in which I tried to explain that I was not merely being willful and perverse, but that I cared a lot for his picture and I liked him a lot, and that if he could stand having somebody who would argue with him for the purposes of the picture, then I'd be glad to come back to work. And he said, fine. And so we worked together for 4.5 months.
On that film?
On that film, yeah.
Am I right? The Hallelujah, I'm a Bum theme runs through much of that.
Yes, it's used in that.
It's used
from time
in that.
To time, but yes.
Many other themes were used. The theme for the little cottage and so forth and all. Beautiful. I love the score of Modern Times. I saw it just a few months ago.
Yes, it's a very nice movie.
Thank you.
Laura. That I guess put David Raskin right. I guess that was the picture, wasn't it? That brought you
your
fame, and you have people like myself coming a few years after, and and there it is. Could you let us remind us what that sounded like? Is it true that they actually started off with a different conception about the music for Laura, a different song, a different
painting? Yes. They started off with several different songs. Ooh. Originally, as I found out, they were going to try to get hold of Summertime, George Gershwin's tune, and use that.
Summertime.
And, yeah. And Ira Gershwin refused to permit them to get the use of that. So then apparently they went over to the prospect of using Sophisticated Lady by Duke Ellington. And that's what they were going to use when I came in on the film.
I see.
And I thought it was the wrong tune for the picture. I mean, much as I like Duke Ellington, much as I like that, I thought it already had too many associations in people's minds, and that they would therefore bring to the picture all kinds of notions and connotations that didn't belong in it. So it took a little persuading, but Preminger agreed to let me try to write a tune of my own over the weekend, and if I came in with something that he liked, he would use that. Otherwise, he would use Sophisticated Lady. And so I wrote the theme and
over the weekend.
That's right.
How many hours did you put in that weekend?
I put in a lot, but then I wrote an awful lot of tunes. I can write tunes, themes very, very fast, and I wrote dozens and dozens of them. None of them were any good, and finally I hit upon that one. And
just the process of hitting on it, though, again.
The process of hitting on it. You're determined to have me tell that corny story.
It's not corny to me.
Well, what happened was that I was slaving away trying to come up with the right piece. And on Saturday morning, I got a letter from a lady with whom I was in love. I was married to her. She was in New York working on a show. And I could not make out this letter. I couldn't figure out what it was that it was saying. And so I put it in the pocket of my working jacket and forgot about it. And then on Sunday night, when I'd about given up the whole thing, I resorted to an old stratagem, which I used to use when I was a kid. If I got stuck on something, ran into a block, I would take a poem or a story or a photograph or a painting or something and put it up on the piano and improvise, and that would take my mind away. So I just reached into my pocket without thinking, took out this letter, smoothed it, and put it on the rack, the piano rack, and began to play. And all of a sudden I realized what the letter was saying, which was, farewell, buddy.
Wow.
And yeah, it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? But at that moment, I hit on the tune just exactly. And wrote it down quickly. Yeah, it sounds
peculiar. Oh, no, I love
it.
Sorry, I love that. I think that's fascinating. I love your camera.
Well, one of these days you may see it in a Warner Brothers picture.
Saul Chaplin. Saul is a producer who was a songwriter. Always. How did you deal with songwriters when you were a producer?
Well, that's one of my favorite questions. I'll tell you why. In almost every case, with the exception of one, I had the most wonderful time with songwriters. Particularly, by the way, with Cole Porter. I worked on, I think, four or five films of which he did a score, one of which was created under my quote-unquote guidance.
Right.
That's kind of exaggerating because he did it, you know. But my first meeting with Cole Porter was on a film called High Society.
Oh, yes.
It's one of my favorite stories. I was sent back to see Cole Porter, begrudgingly, he was my idol, and I was saying to the producer who was then sending me, I said, how can I tell him when anything's bad? He says, he'll be easy, you know. I had to go back. Well, my first meeting with him, he played a song for me, which was beautiful, but it wasn't right for the picture. Well, I wasn't going to tell that to Cole Porter. So I said, oh, it's a beautiful song, it's wonderful. He says, listen to it again. He played it again, and I repeat, I was even more effusive. He says, come here. And he sat me down on the sofa. He says, I can tell that you have reservations about that song. He said, if we're going to work together, you have to tell me what your reservations are. If I agree with you, I'll either change it or write a new song. If I don't agree with it, we'll use it the way it is. So I told him my reservations were. I said, well, in this spot, we had kind of visualized an old-fashioned kind of song that maybe their parents even sang. And I gave him reasons. This is Bing and Grace Kelly. And he said, you're right. And the next week, I came back and heard the song, which was the hit of the picture.
Oh, gosh. What an experience.
True Love.
Yes.
The song was True Love,
yeah.
Which he wrote.
Isn't that?
And our whole experience was like that all the time. And yeah. he was wonderful to work with.
Lional Newman.
Lionel, what are the functions of music in a dramatic movie? What's the music in there for?
Oh, my Lord, it's so many, many times it's to, forgetting the picture being bad, if the picture is good, you enhance the characters, you develop and get inside. The difficulty in composing is that at best, motion pictures are fragmentary, they're vertical. And music, to be good, has to be linear. And it can't be vertical. And the meanwhile, back at the ranch, as they say sometimes, it has to have a line to it, and it has to enhance the scene as far as color is concerned, as far as mood is concerned, and as far as melodic line is concerned.
It's a complicated.
It's very technical too. Very technical.
What would be is there a major problem in composing music for films above any other problem? One real central problem.
I think one of the central problems is getting the right material for a given picture, then developing that material according to the picture. Sometimes you might have a fine composer who expresses himself rather than the picture, and it intrudes on the picture rather than becoming an asset.
Henry Mancini.
I can conceive of a sequence, or as we were talking about, the kind of thing. Just walking around or driving in the car, if a particular sequence gives me a problem, I am able to, and I'm sure that all the other boys that do what I do are the same way, to conceive the thing in your head.
Mancini, one of my favorite Henry Mancini scores is Moon River for Breakfast at Tiffany's. And I'm wondering,
if you could take us through the creative process by which you devised, you created that incredible piece, and tell us of any
problems. It's only a waltz.
Beauty, it's a beauty, it's a beauty. You know, too.
I got to be known as the waltz king. You know, I had a whole string of them. It started with Moon River, and then went to Dear Heart, The Sweetheart Tree, Charade. That's enough right there.
That's not
quite I'm a qualified waltz king.
You really are. That's
March King, too. I've done all of those. Well, Moon River was a difficult scene, a piece to write, because in the script, in the original novella, Truman Capote had just a little thing. It was a couplet, I think, or four lines, where it says Holly, she goes out on the fire escape, and then it has these lines. And this was a very important part of the picture, because lyrically, which was not my problem, but was with Johnny Mercer's problem, it had to be her over the rainbow. It had to be her alter ego. Because here's a well-dressed girl who takes $25 to go to the ladies' room. You have to find out that it's not what you see on the screen. And the song told us that she did have a heart, and I think it was a very crucial scene in establishing her character in the first half of the picture. So to get the melody, I fooled around a long time. I went through all kinds of numbers trying to find out what kind of a piece. That's the whole thing. The writing of a piece is easy. It's what trying to find out what kind of a piece you're going to write.
What do you do to try to find? Are you working the piano entirely?
You look at the piano. You look at the piano a lot.
You just
look at it and challenge it. And then you look at the paper, and it's a lot of looking goes on sometimes. But it's I was working on this thing for the longest time, and I remember I was all alone one night. This is when we lived in Northridge, California, which is over the hill from us here in the San Fernando Valley. And I was all alone. It was getting down to the deadline, and I was trying to think of this thing, and I had dinner, you know, and then I had a couple of blasts after dinner, you know. And I was kind of loose. I wasn't flaccid, you know, I wasn't flopping around or anything like that. I was just loose. And it just all of a sudden, and it came to me that a waltz would be nice. I mean, waltz didn't have anything to do with it, really, but the simplicity of the melody, you know, it's all in the white keys. If you play it in C, it's all in the white keys, which doesn't make it good or bad. It just makes it playable on the white keys. But it's a simple thing, you know, and it doesn't, it's not complicated at all. So it almost wrote itself once I got started. And, of course, it took about no more than an hour once I did get going, if that. It's the kind of thing, once you start, a lot of composers, I think, will tell you about songs, that once you get into it, one thing leads to another, and it almost writes itself.
Miklos Rozsa.
The music should not illustrate the picture. This is unnecessary. You see it, you know it. But it should complete the psychological effect. Something that you cannot say, something that you cannot show, but something you only can feel. And that's the music.
What does music mean to a film, to you?
The soul.